reports that it was a plane that struck the World Trade Center. That may be the case, but this whole area is being shut down. There's pieces of debris and other matter all over the area.
Mike, this is a big one, Mike. We heard it's a plane crash, but we don't know yet.
Well, my best bet for you is to try and get out of there as soon as you can, okay? Just get out of there.
On September the 11th, 2001, countless heroes died. But against the backdrop of chaos and carnage, others were born. During the first few moments following the terrorist attack on our city, a line of transit workers stood shoulder to shoulder with fire, police, EMS employees. With 7 subway stations and 50 bus stops in the area, the New York City transit workers felt a strong connection with the hundreds of thousands of commuters and tourists they brought to the World Trade Center area each day.
We are standing 1,377 feet above Manhattan on the world's highest man-made observation deck. Right now we're overlooking Brooklyn, but you get to see Midtown Manhattan, the Statue of Liberty, Queens, everything from here, Bronx, on a nice clear day. With just the naked eye, you can see as far as Coney Island, probably about 25 miles, 30 miles. With the binoculars, 80.
How about the unique view here about the feeling of Manhattan Island?
You know, it's an interesting thing with views. First of all, man has always been fascinated by heights, whether it's climbing to the top of Mount Fuji or looking at the world from, you know, the bird's eye view, as we say. There are some obvious things. We were downstairs a few minutes ago, and there was a gentleman speaking in Japanese, and there was very little that I understood, except that he pointed down and said to his mother, "Matchbox cars," which gives you a feeling of, I guess, omnipotence when you're up here and everything's so small, but also at the same time insignificance because you have this vast city in front of you. As I indicated, we have a 365-degree walk-around promenade, which means that you can see all of the boroughs and beyond a little bit.
Laura, what do people encounter when they come up onto the observation deck?
Well, the first thing that they're going to encounter is the wonderful vistas. We have windows that go actually below the floor to the ceiling. You can step down into a well area and look at the city between your feet, which is kind of it's a little scary, but wonderful, absolutely wonderful. They will, in addition to the vistas, of course, we have our souvenir shops. We have all the simulated helicopter ride and the monitors, and we have a food court, which is interesting food court because it's themed, I gather, very realistically after a MTA subway stop, and 2 shiny stainless steel doors that have an MTA logo on it. And standing on the 107th floor, 1,310 feet above Manhattan, we do have folks that come and ask us where exactly they pick up the train.
The morning rush to Manhattan was in full swing at 8:46 a.m. September the 11th. But that would be the last normal day for the World Trade Center and our city.
On the morning of September 11th, I was sitting here on Greenwich and Park Place with my fiance, and our sunroof was open, and all of a sudden I hear this plane overhead, and I can hear him gun the engine, and I'll never forget the sound because it went, bam, bam.
Winston, are you with us?
Yes, I am.
Winston, you're a photographer?
Yeah, I work for Transit News.
Okay, can you tell us what you saw, Winston?
Yeah, I'm sitting in the car, and I heard this plane overhead, and then all of a sudden, I thought it sounded kind of louder, then I looked up, and all of a sudden, it smashed right dead into the center of the World Trade Center. Big flash of flame, fire coming out from all over, then the bricks is a huge hole right now. It almost looks like the plane probably went through. I'm not sure.
Winston, can you see? Are you on the north side there where the plane made contact?
Yes, I am.
Now, when you say a huge hole, one of our earlier witnesses, Libby Clark, said not much of the plane came down off the building.
Into the building.
It's in the building, that from what you can see.
Right.
Now, can you see if there's a lot of debris downstairs, Winston?
No, because it looked like it inverted with the impact. Everything went inside the building.
Inside.
The only thing that came out was a little bit of the outside awning. But I'd say the hole is, let me just get a better look right now.
Okay, go ahead.
We'll the, I said the hole takes about, looks like 6-7 floors were taken out. And there's more explosions right now. Hold on, people are running.
Wait,
hold
on just a moment. We've got an explosion inside.
The building's exploding right now. You got people running up the street.
Okay.
Hold on, I'll tell you what's going on.
Okay, just put Winston on pause there for just a moment.
Okay, the whole building just exploded some more. The whole top part.
Okay.
The building's still intact. People are running up the streets. Am I still connected?
Winston, this would support probably what Libby and you both said, that perhaps the fuselage was in the building that would cause a second explosion such as that.
Well, that's what just happened then.
That certainly...
Yeah, people are running up.
We are getting word that perhaps...
Okay, hold on. The people here are... Everybody's panicking.
Actually running from the stage deli when the second tower collapsed. When that second building collapsed, we just saw a puff of smoke outside and we knew that we had to get away from the location because we were very close.
I could see the station was getting smoke and started entering the station. I started hitting the horn. Whenever we bypassed the station, we first hit the horn, I don't know, cloths, rags, anything they really had, and waving frantically. These people were scared, and these people were really scared. And I remember this one woman, I saw her eyes. It was like, even though her face was covered, all you saw was fear. Everybody on that platform was scared. I let my conductor know that we're gonna pick these people up. As he agreed, he had no problem with that. As was hitting the other end of the station to stop the train, I tried to let command center know that they need to get people down there, that there's still a lot of people on a platform. Conductor made another announcement that not to try to get off the train, that it's an emergency and we're just picking people up. And luckily, for the most part, we had a rush hour crowd, but they were cooperative. Only one person tried to get off the train. And I don't know if it was the station agent at his near his location or if his other customers convinced him to get back on the train, but everybody got on. Command by then had gotten back to me, authorizing me to stop and pick him up. But that was already being done. There's just no way to leave him. You can't just leave him like that.
He was fantastic. I mean, the whole time we were on the train, he kept coming over the PA system, letting us know what was going on, letting us know what to expect from everything that he was hearing. And I thought that was fantastic. I would really like to meet him to say thank you, because without that, I think a lot of people would have been even more worried on the train, because we're underground and we don't know what's going on.
We didn't know who was in the train station itself or whatever. Next thing you know, everybody runs off the train. There's debris and smoke falling. And we see the conductor, the motorman coming down, telling everybody to please get back on the train. We have to get out of here. He closed the doors. We went to the next stop, City Hall, and he comes out and makes an announcement that a plane had hit the Trade Center.
You know, with the smoke coming down, I figured something was going on upstairs. And we got everybody on the train, closed down, and we proceeded.
Train operator Joe Irizarry's quick thinking saved the day and didn't go unnoticed.
I was told to call control center. My first reaction is, okay, what did I do wrong? Okay, and I was informed, don't worry, it's not something you did wrong, it's actually something you did right for a change.
When did you think to reach out to the motorman?
Actually, it took me a few days because of the shock of everything, and then when I started getting my composure back, because I did lose a lot of friends, then I decided I must call and do something to say thank you to somebody that could be, you know, slip through the cracks.
Words unspoken, emotions formed a silent release.
I was looking for you the other day. I think we hugged, and both of us had tears in our eyes at that time. I'm glad you're here.
Oh, good again to see you. Thank you.
And thanks for finding me.
The MTA did.
It's a good feeling, you know, to think somebody, you know, considers you a hero. I still say that's what we do every day down here. That's our job, to keep our customers safe.
While subway crews and station workers heroically saved thousands of passengers underground, chaos reigned above, as New Yorkers frantically looked for an escape route from Lower Manhattan, which had begun to look like a war zone.
To the NYC Transit Staten Island Express bus, from Teresa Betancourt. I was spared the collapse of the second building only because of the courageous acts of your driver, Anthony Gallo. Anthony rescued about 11 people from the smoke and debris that had overtaken us when the first building had fallen.
Smoke just picked me up and literally pushed me into the glass. It was thick, it was black. My throat had gotten clogged with all the dirt. I couldn't breathe. Somebody had started to yell about breaking the glass on the windows, and somebody had said to walk them hand to hand, which is what we did. We walked the rest of the way to the corner hand to hand. I could see the smoke cleared pretty fast. I could see headlights. I didn't know what it was, and I could hear somebody's voice. I thought they were saying to get on the bus, but they were saying later on, I found out, was follow my voice. I literally handed past the entire bus. The gentleman on the bus came out to get us in the midst of all this black smoke.
After the people started banging on the bus all around the sides, I mean, you couldn't see outside the bus, I just opened the door and I said, follow my voice. And about 11 people started coming on the bus. They were choking, crying. And I think I just did what any other human being would have done. I mean, you hear people banging on the outside of the door. They actually gave me a purpose. I knew then that I wasn't dead, that everything was okay. So now, if I could pass that on to somebody else, what the heck?
When I first stepped on the bus, it was a breath of fresh air. I didn't know how long before I had breathed fresh air at that moment. Relief.
What would you say to Anthony after you saw him?
Oh, God, Anthony is like my guardian angel that I've been dying to meet for a long time. Thank you. Thank you from the bottom of my heart.
I don't know how to thank you.
Okay. I don't know how to thank you,
you
for
did,
nothing.
You did. All right.
While Gallo assisted people near the Brooklyn Battery Tunnel, bus operator Chandler had his hands full as well.
Looking out of the midst of nowhere, appeared a New York City Transit personnel person. He had on a hard hat, sort of like a raincoat type of gear. I don't know if he worked down underground or what. By this time, I don't know exactly like where people were coming from, out of the woodworks looked like. People had severe injury, laceration to the face, arms area. People had open wounds in the heads. Some people had succumbed to, I don't know if it's smoke inhalation, or a couple ladies had, I believe, asthma attacks. So I had to try to establish some degree of calm. So I opened the door of the bus, talked to him, then the people began to come on the bus. I helped assist some people who were not able to come on board the bus of their own ability. like I said, some had passed out, and this particular gentleman and the security person were helping two ladies. They passed the lady to me. I helped her on the bus. There was another lady in a building saying, wait for me, help me. We went and got her, put her on the bus. By this time, I guess we got about 25 people on the bus, but people were so excited to the point it was being yelled out, leave them out there, let's get out of here, we're gonna die. I said, you know, what I have to do is follow instruction. My instruction is to get you out of this area to a safe location.
Well, of course, we were standing here, the initial impact, and I was told there was a hole in the building. So we knew immediately that they were going to need us downtown because we know what happened with the World Trade Center the last time. And while I was sitting here, we watched the next impact and we watched the buildings fall down. So we think on our feet around here. It took about 10 seconds to know that they needed us.
As a stunned city, country, and world looked on, transit did what it does best. And in a way no one ever imagined, it moved New York.
Within minutes, emergency plans were in place, and from transit's command center, rail and bus movements were coordinated.
The time is 8:40.
Professionalism, the men and women of transit. Not one employee, passenger, train, or bus was lost. During the days and months that followed after the attack, over 4,000 employees worked around the clock to search for victims and restore service to Lower Manhattan.
The cataclysm of September 11th caught everyone off guard. Although New York City Transit has been conducting disaster drills for years and planning for every possible scenario, nothing in Transit's experience had prepared them for what happened that day. During the initial moments after the collapse, getting the trains out of the stations and removing passengers to safety was crucial. That's where the years of planning and drills paid off.
We were sent down here to investigate how many trains were left in the area. What was the damage that was caused by the explosions? So the first station that we went to was Cortland on the N and the R. We checked that station. We found there was a partial train in the station with about three cars, no one on the train. Then we came to Rector Street on the 1. There wasn't any train there. We saw debris and water. Then we walked the tunnel up to Cortland Street and we got within about 300 feet, give or take, of Cortland. That's when we saw the building that collapsed right down to the World Trade. There was furniture from the World Trade Center down into the tracks and steel beams, and it was a total destruction down there.
What was it like trying to get the trains out?
Well, we had 20 cars down in a flood condition, the water above the threshold plates, whereas the door opening that where you walk into the passenger car, it was about 8 to 10 inches above that. So once they used the pump equipment to get the water out of the tunnels, we had to go rescue those trains.
With the subway temporarily closed and the city frozen, New York City Transit buses became a lifeline for thousands.
Our buses evacuated hundreds of people from the immediate site and clearly also cleared out a lot of people from the entire Lower Manhattan area, literally thousands of people during the immediate collapse of the World Trade Center.
Hudson, from Hudson Pier and from Westside Depot, they had organized the certain routes that had come down here no longer obviously could come down here, and they quickly converted them into units that would bring in the police and the fire and sanitation, anybody that was needed at the site.
We've been supplementing service for the city, taking care of shuttling fire department, police department personnel back and forth, doctors, nurses, back and forth, getting the exhausted personnel up down to go home, to get new personnel downtown. Been a busy day.
We're using the Transit Authority buses for transportation for the police officers to go to different sites in the city of New York.
How's that been working out for you?
Excellent. The TA has been nothing but helpful with their transportation, the bus drivers, the supervisors that we have been contacting with to get the buses down here have been nothing but excellent.
immediately following the attack at the World Trade Center, our buses were involved in providing support to the police department, OEM, the fire department. We estimate that over 300 buses were involved in the immediate aftermath, providing support to the rescue and recovery effort.
Hours after the attack, MTA New York City transit workers were on hand at Ground Zero, assisting in any way they could. But they, like everyone else who responded, were not prepared for the devastation they encountered.
In the face of this worst attack our country's ever seen on our soil, we were able to respond so quickly, and the MTA is an incredible example. 10:30 in the morning, all service was gone. A little after 12:30, it was beginning to come back, and by the middle of the afternoon, it was more than two-thirds back, and it's a tremendous tribute to the courage and the sacrifice of our MTA workers. And it wasn't just having the buses and the subways running. It was telling the people of New York that we're not fleeing. No one knew what might happen next. We're not running for home or running for the mountains. We're doing our job, and we're doing it with an extraordinary commitment to the other people. And to have those buses running, to have the subways running, was not just important in and of itself, but it was an important symbolic message that we're not going to be frightened. We're not going to give up and throw up our hands. We're going to respond and get through this. And those early hours set the tone for the weeks and months to come.
When we got down there, the worst thing was you could hear these whistles. And they were just whistling and whistling and whistling. Everything was so quiet, but all you could hear was whistling. And finally, you know, because it was irritating me, this is after a couple of hours, late in the afternoon, about 3-4 o'clock in the afternoon. I was asked if I was tired. The firemen, police, and everything down there, they were trying to take bodies out, but they were worried, you know, about the drivers and stuff. And somebody said something to me, and I said, it's just so irritating. Why don't they cut the electricity so that noise could go off? Because I thought that maybe it was like alarms in the building, you know, that had fallen, and they just didn't cut the electricity off. Cut it off. That noise was annoying. And one of the firemen said to me, they can't cut it off. Those are the monitors that are on the firemen so that when they get lost in buildings during smoke, that we're able to locate them. And at that point, it hit me what all the whispering had been around me, you know, about the firemen, that they were stuck. That all that whistling was the fact that they could not get to them, and they were in there and they were dying.
Workers, structure maintainers, signal maintainers all over the city. When their tours ended on a midnight tour, they all flocked down here. Nobody told them to come. They were in the pile along with everybody else. The day went on, we were on a pile. It was before, everybody says there's a bucket brigade, but there were no buckets there when I first got there. There were no buckets at all. Everybody was going through the pile by hand.
We pulled the steel beams out with the aid of the firemen and local iron workers. We all worked very well together. And we then assisted in extracting the fireman from the wreckage of his truck.
I was down at Ground Zero, down a hole, alongside a fireman, clearing debris, touching metal that was red hot, and just passing it back and forth. I mean, none of us knew the word tired. A lot of guys were beat, but we kept going because we're all Americans, we're TA workers, and we're working side by side with every agency, every other city agency that's our brother and sister in this land. This beautiful city of New York City.
I'm on the pile, and then I was on the bucket line where they were moving body parts. And it was very devastating looking at, you know, a leg passing you, a finger here, a head there, another piece of a body there. It was very devastating.
I was driving a truck and I had the equipment on it, so that was my responsibility. While Carla was away, I was driving up to the site where they told me to park, and an elderly gentleman jumped on the sideboard of the truck and grabbed on my mirror. He says, "Are you going down there?" I said, "Yeah, I'm going down at, you know, wherever they tell me to go." He says, "I have two sons who are firefighters. Can you get me down there? I gotta know." I said, "Sure." You know, I stopped the truck. I said, "Get in with me." He says, "No, don't even stop. Just go. I gotta know." And, I wish I knew what happened with him, if he ever found his boys.
It's a very good friend of ours, Mike Mullen. And then we had Tom Pickford, his son. He works with us. And we had James Fagan's mother. She worked for Canada Fitzgerald.
Right.
And, it's just... I talked to my friend Pat Mullen when I went home. And, he said...
I picked up the phone about 2:15. I called my National Guard unit in Jamaica, Queens. And they told me that the government had notified them that we had been activated. We walked a trail of dust, and we started from where we were, and we just followed.
Is this a transit employee?
Just walking in the dust, in the dust, in the dust. And we wound up on the other side of the island, walking past a pair of shoes. And it was almost as if... I just imagine this, and maybe the person was blown out of the shoes, or they just left them, you know. And we had a guy in our unit, he lost his life there, and all they found was his head.
I've been on active duty since the event took place. I got off the clock 6 o'clock that morning, went home, and that's when I heard the bad news. And before I knew it, the guard called me, and here I am.
John is just one of the hundreds of transit employees who were out in force to help. In almost every image of what once was the World Trade Center, you can see a transit employee lending a hand.
Helping to move steel, helping with the bucket brigade, anything I can do to help them.
We spent 3 nights going through tunnels, sometimes in boats, other times walking through the debris and crawling up into holes as big as 3 feet.
The first order of business was to clear a path so that emergency personnel could get onto the pile to search for survivors. The 2 main groups that were involved in clearing that path were sanitation, heavy equipment crews, but the bulk were transit workers with payloaders, backhoes, earth movers, and such, clearing paths for the emergency personnel to get on the pile. That is what we were completely engrossed in the hours after the attack.
You know, it was a terrible tragedy. When you watch this thing and you saw all of the people that ultimately lost their lives, the firemen, the police officers, the innocent people that were in those buildings that were attacked, it was a terrible, terrible tragedy to see. One that actually is senseless. You don't understand what the real motivation of it was. But on the other hand, I watched this city pull together in those first days and weeks afterward to a degree I never thought possible. You saw people over there. I spent a lot of time over there right after the incident. I saw people, I saw managers, I saw hourlies, I saw basically people that were black, white, yellow, green, all working. You would have never thought there were any differences in people working together like never before possible. It's a shame it takes a tragedy to see that happen, but it truly was one that really gave my heart a real inspiration to see, because people really worked to try to save and hopefully get people out of those buildings. It truly was a sight to behold.
Well, first I'd like to say there was nobody panicked, which is a credit to the authority. We had 3,500 people came down here to take part in the rescue by the evening. We had 2 miles of trucks. All people wanted to do was help. It didn't matter if you were a policeman, a fireman, an EMS worker, a transit worker, or just a plain civilian. Everybody, all they wanted to do was help. And I just thought it was a fantastic, fantastic response to a very tragic situation.
I see, Hoffman with his boys removing steel beams. Now remember, they needed steel beams removed. Okay, so we have the best and most numerous people who are trained in a short time to remove rails if there's a problem. And these were the perfect crew to take the beams out, to cut the beams so that the rescue people and the medical people could get to victims. And if you remember, there were lots of people that were saved, not only Tuesday, but Wednesday, and they found some people on Thursday. And I think that lots of those people whose lives were saved were as a direct result of MTA and New York City Transit in particular, emergency workers, and the great job they did.
Well, the first night, we were lined up to come down to the site. We lined up about on Chambers Street at home. I had all my trucks lined up. And then they told us that we could go. We had cleared a path, and that we had enough room to get our trucks down to the site, but debris. And I was standing by my third driver in line, and I said, "We're ready to go." I'll say his name is John. And he says to me, "Boss, are those buildings down there that left, are they going to fall on us?" So I was thinking, I said, I don't want to lie to him. Started to think. I said, "John, I have to assume that everything that fell already, that they're not going to fall down." And I also said, "If we don't go down there, who's going to go down there?" We were the only, the first city agency lined up to go down there, and we had to start pulling some steel to rescue people. So he looked at me, nodded his head, and then I climbed around to the side of the truck. I climbed into the truck with him, and I drove down to the site with him so that he would feel better.
We assembled a command quarters, dump trucks, backhoes, the low loader, which is a big forklift, and we were ready to go within 2 hours, and we were heading down there, which that was amazing to begin with, to say, we're going in. And we were the first on the scene to make a path and remove debris so emergency vehicles can get in. And New York City Transit was right on the ball. They were right there.
First couple of hours, we moved around and looked at the disaster. And then a couple of senior guys got together and said, "Hey, look, guys, this is not about the job. This is about us. We got to work. We got to do what it takes to make the city better again."
How you doing?
All right.
Manhattan,
local
23. Staten Island, baby. And what brought you here?
Hey, I'm an American. Can I help out? Can't sit at home and be frustrated.
What do you think?
New Hampshire.
New Hampshire? What brought you here?
Boston.
How'd you get here?
Drove. Me and my brother and my buddy.
My kids were freaking out. They were saying, "Dad, you promised you wouldn't be there. We want you to come home. We want to see you, And that's when my one daughter had written me this, the little sign that I kept. And it says, "I like what you're doing, Dad, but we want you to come home." So I took this and I carried it with me the whole time I was down there, and I kept it in the window of the machine I was using.
At any given time, we had several hundred people here for the first 2 weeks, transit workers. In total, almost 2,500 transit employees were participated in the recovery and the rescue effort.
I thought I had lost my daughter, but thank God she's fine, and I'm here to do whatever I can.
There's a lot of people lost their lives there, and that hurts. I didn't have to know everybody, but I brought those people to work, and I'm not going to have them anymore.
Well, it's been very busy, and I'm also happy because as I'm going down with the bus, I see all kind of signs, all people saying, "We love you, New York City Transit. We thank you and we love you." And that's a good feeling because they appreciate what we're doing.
Thank you very much.
Every time you left the scene and you would come out, people were praising you and clapping, and everybody was happy and cheering, and here you are. You really were mixed. The emotions were like, it was crazy. You really didn't know how to feel because at one end, there's havoc, and at the other end is cheering and praise.
Well, we were involved in removing a MetroCard vending machines and some turnstiles from a station that was actually buried under some of the rubble. And one thing that sticks in my mind is the passenger information board inside the token booth. It had 9/11, no trains running. And I pretty much, I will always remember that.
We couldn't get our trucks down close enough to the control area to move the equipment out, so we had to physically carry them out. The machines weigh over 1,000 pounds each, and we had to carry them into the trucks where we were able to move them off the property. My heart bleeds for everybody that had losses in this fatality. It's
devastation to Lower Manhattan is unbelievable, with surrounding buildings sheared off because of the collapse. Crushed cars littered the streets, and shells of buildings with blown-out windows could be seen around Ground Zero. And seeing piles of debris four stories high cut deep into one's soul.
I feel the pain of every family that lost someone. I feel the struggle of every person helping out here.
These guys, they would have given half of their lifeblood to keep working, but unfortunately, they were so exhausted, we were forced to pull out.
And how do you feel about this whole situation?
It's still hard. I can't. It's been a nightmare. That's it.
All right. Thank you very much, man.
At night, going to sleep, just sweating, and it's like nightmares of montages of bodies, different parts of different bodies connected to each other. Sort of surreal, you know, sort of like superimposed, just one thing on top of another, layer on top of layer, which is something like what it looked like when you were down here.
Kind of nervous standing here because I'm saying, what if I'm standing on somebody's ashes?
Even though a part of our city was leveled, the pride of our country, our flag, could be seen flying high everywhere.
You know, life is in America has been beautiful to us, and I feel so sad for all of those families that aren't together any longer, and it truly hurts. But we did as much as we could, the little bits that we did. We hope that we're helping our city get back together one piece at a time.
New York City Transit employees were on the job, whether they were on duty or off, and all of them pitched in.
All the ash and muck, basically, that you could see in the street is going to work its way down to our system, so we're going to scrape it all up, clean it up before it gets into our drainage and pumps, and it could turn into a problem. So we're going to clean up all the vents, I imagine, all downtown from here to probably 14th Street.
Like the Broad Street station, most stations in Lower Manhattan were covered in debris. But not so at the Cortlandt Street station on the NNR, as most of the entrances were directly across the street from the Twin Towers. And a cracked water main pipe poured water onto the tracks.
We've been pumping in 2 days 26 million gallons of water. But we're talking about here's enough water to probably fill Shea Stadium. That's a lot of water.
And the debris from the collapsed towers blocked several hundred feet of tunnel on the 1 and 9 lines.
Because of the unimaginable amount of debris above ground, access to the tunnels and stations were blocked. Engineers weren't able to assess the extent of the damage.
Under the Chase building, that's about where our 1 and 9 train came out. Under the building, the 1 and 9 tunnels are fine. We've had people in there, and that's the station, the Cortlandt Street station. And that part of the station, you can actually walk in. But as you head further south, you see a little bit of ceiling collapse, and then eventually the whole tunnel is collapsed. So this area right out in front of me here is fully collapsed, all the way down to Liberty Street. And then once you get past Liberty Street, the tunnel is secure again.
The cleanup effort by construction workers from New York City Transit and the private sector allowed engineers to go into the partially collapsed subway to see exactly how bad the damage really was.
These steel beams behind me came from the 80th floor. They speared down 30 feet into the earth adjacent to the subway box.
We're standing in the underpass from the northbound platform over to the southbound platform under the NNR. We've got the train tracks right over us. This was the passageway up to the World Trade Center. And as I get up close here, I can see the steel columns that we saw above ground that were from the 80th floor of the South Tower of the Trade Center that came down and pierced through all of the overburden, the dirt above, and pierced through here, and we think are sticking down another 10 or 20 feet. They were sticking up 70 feet into the air. But those steel columns acted like spears, just shot down, and we're just lucky that it was outside our subway box.
With an estimated 1.2 million tons of debris above ground and a threat of flooding in the subways, transit workers wasted no time in shoring up the damaged tunnels so the other trains can continue running in downtown Manhattan.
We're standing in the 1 in 9 tunnel, about a block and a half south of the World Trade Center complex. This is a concrete wall. We're standing in the southbound track, but there's a similar wall on the northbound track. It's about 3 feet thick, and we put it in the last 2 weeks. And there's a similar set of walls at the north end, about a block and a half north of the World Trade Center. And this is to prevent water passing into our tunnels if, by chance, the basement gets flooded at the World Trade Center. So it's a precautionary measure. We could take the wall down when we want to run trains again.
Initially, it was thought that it would be years before service could be restored to the collapsed portions of the subway. However, transit's engineering and construction teams have been working around the clock to restore service south of Chambers Street on the 1 and 9 and NNR trains so that passengers could resume their normal commute.
It's great to see how quickly things are coming back. I go down, you know, even though the official ground zero services and removal are over, I still go down. I think New Yorkers will go down as long as we're alive. And you see the 1 and the 9 and the 2 and the 4 and the progress that is being made, and it's just extraordinary. And what is really encouraging to me is that this massive recovery and removal effort was made and there was not one serious injury. And it's a tribute to the professionalism of the workers and the fact that New Yorkers know what they're doing. And I'm just very, very proud of how well we have continued to respond through today.
Over 300 construction workers and some 30 engineers work 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, to rebuild the subway box here at Ground Zero. And they're laying more than just tracks, but an important, vital part of transportation to Lower Manhattan, making this construction site a labor of love, sending a message to the world, we shall overcome.
February this year, we awarded an emergency contract. We've got contractors working 24 hours, 7 days a week over there, rebuilding the subway. And by November of 2002, we're going to have subways restored to Ground Zero and all throughout Manhattan.
When I was last out here with a filming crew, I was standing in a station where the beams were all twisted, there were holes in the roof, and, you know, it was a structure that was greatly distressed by what had gone on. I'm amazed, actually, and I feel positive the work that's gone on to remove all of the damaged areas and the reconstruction effort. It's phenomenal. We've got crews working around the clock, and it's a very positive attitude out here because we're rebuilding. We're part of the process of rebuilding, and I think for everyone involved in this job, it's been emotionally positive to be able to be part of rebuilding Lower Manhattan and making things better after something so awful happened.
Like, it's an honor to actually be here in this site. I look past the money, and I look past the prestige. I look at what this is still, as far as I'm concerned, part of the recovery. It's a recovery of the site itself now. The bodies have already been recovered, but the site has not been recovered yet. You know, the actual total rehabilitation will be when the site is completed and the job is done.
The total reconstruction of the subway box is within the Trade Center site about 1,400 feet, but there's additional work that continues on past the structural work, which track work and signals and so forth, and that goes on for close to a mile down to the lower tip of Manhattan.
The first section is about, like I said, over 200 feet, going to take more than 1,000 yards of concrete just around it still. And naturally, the other stage is going to take much more. So many, many thousands of yards of concrete going to go to replace the subway.
All of the electrical and track work is progressing on either side of me as we're talking. So hopefully we're going to meet right in the middle. It'll be similar to, you know, what could you say, the Transcontinental Railroad or something, except this is all going to be done underground. When we reopen for customer service, the trains will run from Chambers Street through the Cortlandt Street station. They will stop at Rector Street and then down south of Rector, down to the South Ferry. We're reconstructing the station structurally, but the finishes, the access to the station, that's all going to be left to the future when it's determined what exactly will be built on the World Trade Center site. Then we'll complete the finishing, the lighting, all of the rest that makes a subway station. but the trains will proceed at speed from Chambers Street through Cortlandt Street down to Rector Street.
City Transit's going to be here forever. We've been here 100 years. We're going to be here at least another 100, another 1,000 years. No matter what they do to us, we move the city of New York, and we are going to return and restore and always be part of this city. They can hit us. They can hurt us. They're not going to kill us. We're going to come back, and we're going to come back even stronger.
You just see steel going up. You see the subway taking shape again. You see the station starting to take shape again. You see the path tracks to come into the basement of the World Trade Center that was, and all of a sudden you realize it'll all be back, and a generation or two will look at pictures. That's all they have. You know, it's and it does. I guess you heal. You know, but it takes. I don't think this generation will from this, but the next one will probably.
I would want my grandchildren's children to not so much look at the bombing or look at the destruction of the World Trade Center as much as to look at the what was done afterwards and how much everyone pulled together to try and find survivors, try and clean up the area, and really just to help, try and help each other.
My children's children and my grandchildren, to know that it happened and it won't happen again.
Yeah, I would want my children's children to know what happened, what the circumstances were, and I'd want them to know how, as a city and a country, that we united, and it seemed we had a newfound patriotism in this country.
This is the outcome of people hating other people. Just the total, you know, disregard how you treat children when they're born, how they're raised, what they're taught, and they become men, women, and the hate just grows inside them that they see nothing but you as the evil person and them as the rulers or whatever.
Live every minute to the fullest, make the best of it, because you never know when something like this is going to happen again. I hope and I pray that it doesn't, but you can't walk around in fear, because then they won't. But don't waste a minute on this earth.
You just got to tell them, you got to help one another. The world is getting smaller and smaller, and we're all going to have to live together. And just like everyone got together and they helped each other out down at the site, and just do a little bit, help everyone, anyone you see, just help everyone a day. Even if you do one good deed a day, it just helps, and, you know, just be kind.
Mr. Tough Guy is letting you know he's going to take you down. He's going to win the argument. And when my grandson asked me, was it going to happen again, I told him anything's possible. As long as you're alive, anything's possible. What we're not going to do is wake up every morning and be worried about the fact that we can't go to the store or go to the country or go swimming when we feel like it. We're going to do it. Whenever we have a few pennies and that car still got gas in it, we're going and we're going to come right back in and we're going to go to sleep. And they kind of got the gist of it. I think they started to relax a little bit.
Some people compare this to Pearl Harbor, but the difference between Pearl Harbor and 9/11 was Pearl Harbor was a military base. Well, World Trade Center wasn't. It was civilians, it was a workplace. That is, I think, a bigger impact than Pearl Harbor was. Thousands of non-military people who were actually not responsible for whatever it was that the terrorists claimed that America is responsible for. All these people do is punch a card for a living. We weren't there pulling triggers or nothing.
How do they strike back at us? Well, they strike back at us hitting a symbol of America, which is the Trade Center. But that's not what America is. America is not the buildings. The MTA is not its trains and tracks and stations and bridges and tunnels. The MTA is 65,000 people working in unison. And anybody tells me that that doesn't happen, I say you're wrong, because I was there that day and I saw the way it worked. I saw people taking charge of issues, doing things that you would never expect them to be doing. We didn't have any National Guard. We had only our own police and only our own forces. And it's that what makes the MTA a great place to be chairman of, but it's also that's what makes America a great place to live in.
And I think we did a good job also. And I don't think there was enough credit given to the transit workers who moved the millions of people that day and did not get anybody injured, and who continued to move the millions of people, who kept the city going. I think the men and women of transit did a great job, and I'm very happy to have been a transit worker.
It's like, for some reason, it almost felt alone. Maybe even as New York, it's almost felt alone. It's because, I mean, a lot of people do tend to forget the Pentagon, or seem to forget the Pentagon, as well as the plane that went down in Pennsylvania. But somehow there's a certain isolation that, like, almost like we were picked out, New Yorkers were picked out for the attack. But when I saw all those people, I mean, right off the bat, sending help and trying to send help, I actually felt, okay, we're going to get through this.
It wasn't just the emergency services, the police and fire and EMTs who acted as heroes on that day. Thousands of ordinary New Yorkers showed incredible courage, and in particular, so many of our MTA workers responded with an incredible willingness to risk their lives to protect the people and to help the people of New York.
The men and women of MTA New York City Transit would like to thank you for taking the time to watch this historic documentary. And I also feel that the moment is historic. For it was on that fateful day, here at this place, that our city, our state, our nation, our people were put to the test. And once again, as Americans, we arose to face the challenge. I'm Oscar Davis, and I thank you for watching. I thank you also for riding with New York City Transit.
Yeah. shall live in peace.
We shall live.
If you have any questions, comments, or just want to share your thoughts with us, email us at transittransitnews@nyct.com or write to us at 130 Livingston Street, Brooklyn, New York, 11201.